Welcome back. This is Discourses on Strivalism, Season 2, Episode 6, Values of Strivalism. Before we get into it, make sure that you give us a like, subscribe, don't forget to comment. In today's political discourse, it is often difficult to ascertain the true meaning or intent behind the rhetoric, especially when masked with suffixes, such as pro or anti. What exactly do these things mean, and what do they tell us of the movements with which they correspond? What does someone stand for when the premise of their ideologue begins with anti? Humans are categorizing creatures. We are creatures of habit. We want to project patterns on all things and actions so that we may contain or simplify them. When we create patterns with buzzwords, discussion topics, vocabulary, etc., we find some semblance of continuity. We constantly funnel down the complex systems of reality so that we may operate more smoothly without being entranced by every minute detail. It is within the gravitation towards this continuity that we create an in-group that can all function with the same reductionist views. The Western system is rife with a material reductionist mindset, and it affects every aspect of our existence. This reduction of information makes it impossible to understand the symbology and nature of the world around us. How could we understand the world before us if we only use the lens of the technological materialist? How can we propel ourselves into the future with such a lens? Mm. In a complex world, we long for something simple. We're lazy in this sense. Everyone wants to be in the in-group because of the resources it provides, without us even giving much effort towards it. This longing for being welcomed into a fold, so to speak, is an act of sacrificing the independent self to become an individual within a system, a cog in the machine. This is the antithesis of life, as we do not exist to experience pure entertainment or even happiness 24/7. The patterns and continuity that the masses want to manifest in the world are what drive them to surround themselves with like individuals, and this effectively is creating an echo chamber.
So the millennia of evolution, which has gotten us to this point in our story, our current form, has carefully crafted the human being into a being of both the social and the antisocial. We long to belong, yet we also yearn for independence and freedom. We exist in complex webs of familial and social ties, yet our emotions and motivations can be independent. We often seek to project our uniqueness and oneness onto the world as a way of proving and advertising our own value. But this is an easily corruptible balance between the social and the antisocial. The common man can be molded and manipulated into belonging not to what he could be or what would be good, but what he is told to belong to. This is what the masses do. It is the essence of their being in a group. Just as well, he can be manipulated into projecting what he perceives to be good, or worse yet, what he is told is good.
Yeah, and we can expect that kind of view from the apathist, mm-hmm. right? The apathist almost projects or advertises mm-hmm. these things. And when the masses pick up what is good, they almost inherently drive towards it. And we talked about this a few episodes ago, or maybe even last episode, that people will sacrifice their own belief systems in order to become more virtuous because... Mm-hmm. Well, more recently on YouTube or social media or wherever, you know, mind you, all these things have algorithms which mm-hmm. funnel people towards this same like mindset. It has to be for a reason. There's no randomness to it, right? And so companies want you to have a certain value, or someone somewhere wants you to have a certain value. And this is, if you trace the steps, if you follow the threads, if you will, mm-hmm. We'll start finding who these apathists are. But in general, I think the masses are, as I've said before, they're not independent thinkers. They're just but individuals within a larger system. And so in order to function within that system and as I said before, smoothly go about life, they almost have to grease themselves with the social lubricants, if you will.
Right.
Right. And so I think in order to function a lot of times in the Western system, this industrial society, the material reductionist viewpoint, things like that, I think there are narratives being pushed or these groups are being pushed, and people naturally will flow into these groups. And so it's quite dangerous. The masses are what will ultimately lead to the destruction of Western civilization.
And there's a concerted effort by certain people to take advantage of that. It's just as we were talking about, the masses, it's part of their essence is being corralled or manipulated or used or directed in a certain direction. And there are people that take an active role in taking some sort of benefit from that.
Right. And you see it in the news. I've said this before, where you're presented with only the information that they want you to see.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. And they want you to react a certain way. So they will say certain words to flare up and elicit emotional responses, mm-hmm. so that the people watching, whether it be Fox News, CNN, or wherever, right, people will act a certain way once they get information. And as you were saying, they're getting corralled into mm-hmm. doing something. And so the masses as a whole, it doesn't matter what country they're in. It doesn't matter if they fall in the West, if they fall in the Middle East, the Far East.
They function the same.
They function the same in that they can be manipulated into doing whatever. And they can be told it's good. I mean, I think it was Heidegger that was talking about delusion, right? The third step is really the most important. The third and final step of delusion is saying that things are self-evident, right? And we can see that now. It's no longer, at first it's the emotional, oh, well, it feels right. It feels like justice. And then the second portion is, well, the science backs it up. Well, when the science isn't necessarily backing it up, or maybe it does to such a degree that, well, it's just self-evident that this is good or this is right, this action or this behavior. And so, honestly, I think the masses are deluded. Sorry.
It's like a hysteria almost.
Well, right, because if you look at any of the talking points for both Republicans or Democrats or people on the right
and left.
People on the left in general, you'll find that most people on the right always funnel their conversation down to a few points, mm-hmm. right? And that's not the entire premise of conservatism. And honestly, conservatism and progressivism both believe in progress,
mm-hmm.
because the conservatives are trying to slow it down.
It's just the pace.
It's the pacing. That's right. And conservatives generally don't have some ideal anchored in the past. It's just do everything slowly. So
more of like a caution to change.
Right. But their end goal is still change.
Mm-hmm.
It's not
controlled gradual change as
right.
opposed to radical.
Yeah. Conservatism is not traditionalism.
No.
I find it funny that especially in the United States that conservatives conserve what was liberal maybe a decade ago.
Yes.
Right. One of the funniest images I can recall is that the anti-gay stance of the Republican Party for the majority of time, and the Democrat Party, but more so I'm focusing on the Republicans right now, right? And now some of their spokespeople are like trans or whatever, right?
And Caitlyn Jenner is a Republican.
Right, like staunchly.
Right.
Which is
asinine. It's crazy to me that this guy, you know, went through all these whatever changes and he is on the side of people who are against his own sort of identity. And Republicans are like, oh yeah, That's fine.
Yeah, they almost welcome it. It's almost like a, they have token people.
Yes. Now. Look at my African American over there. Aren't you the greatest?
I just find the entirety of political discourse right now shallow and pedantic.
Yes.
Vague and unconvincing.
At best.
But I think the masses will always succumb to the dulling of what was once sharp. We see this in current political debate, where the right wing begins to cave and utilize the vocabulary of the left just to be part of the discussion, whether it's by their own conscious volition or not. Specifically, most recently, you will see the idea, since transgenderism is such a big deal, right? Normally, when someone would think of Republican or right-wing American, they would think of somebody with a Southern accent, mm-hmm. and that they would be calling everyone, you know, mm-hmm. or whatever, like indiscriminately, right? Mm-hmm. But now you're seeing that in right-wing circles, the use of the terminology or the acronym LGBTQ+, mm-hmm. and things like that, and it's, we have to utilize the left's vocabulary in order to be part of the political discussion. Mm-hmm. And we can't, this is why I'm saying that conservatives only conserve what was liberal 10 years ago, because mm-hmm. eventually they do succumb to it. Conservatives aren't traditionalists. They really have no set moral values. Mm-hmm. If they're willing to sacrifice it to, you know, be part of the discussion, right. be part of the progress, then why are we voting for them at all?
Well, it's essentially that the conservatives are consistently ceding control to the people that are setting the frame, which would be the right. left. I mean, you were just talking about it with the LGBTQ+ or whatever. If you call them
the HDTV community,
yes,
or HGTV,
LGTV,
community.
Or something like that.
Yeah.
But as soon as you start using the terminology that these people come up with, then you're validating it. And by validating it, you're giving it power. And the right. more that you take a reactionary stance to it, the more you, it snowballs from there.
Right. And I think Ernst Jünger once said that 2% resistance or any resistance to something almost legitimizes it. Mm-hmm. Right? And he was more so talking about a political party that's in power and it has a 2% resistance in terms of votes. Mm-hmm. Right. 2% of the population maybe votes somewhere else. And to him, that seemed like it only legitimizes the 98%. It almost even galvanizes them. Mm-hmm. Right. And what I meant earlier by the dulling of what was once sharp is if you have a set of principles, right? It was Julius Evola that said, be radical, have principles, mm-hmm. right? If you make principles for yourself, you're essentially making a sword or some sort of sharp item with right. which you are to cut down everything else around you, cut mm-hmm. the chaff, you know, separate chaff from wheat, do whatever you have to do, right? That's you being sharp. You have
cut the mustard.
Well, you've disciplined yourself. You've brought yourself a certain set of ethics and morals or values, mm-hmm. whatever, right? Well, if you just give up on those, you're not using the tool of your brain. It's becoming dull, mm-hmm. right? That sharp, independent thought is no longer there, right? And this is just the cycle of humanity right now with the advent of the masses and the techno-industrial society mm-hmm. and everything that we have to deal with and what we've been talking about over the last several podcasts. But this pattern of letting go of morals or ethics or values, things like that, we cannot sustain a civilization with that if we're constantly giving.
Right.
Right. And so the Strivalist seeks to break this pattern. He will not be dull. He will actively sharpen and hone his understanding of the world in its complexity, not reducing it to some profane numerical phenomenon. He lives in a world of observable reality, not an abstract reductionist world that can be manipulated into saying whatever the
right.
the perceiver wants it to be. The Strivalist realizes that he is part of a much greater system, be it the familial unit, the tribe, nation, species, or the ecosystem as a whole. Everything works in tandem with one another, and nothing exists without interaction with some other thing.
Right. So it's clear then that the Strivalist is both social and antisocial. He manifests his potential and sharpens his mind, yet not at the cost of his place in the world. He is social insofar as he knows his duties in his family, his community, and his responsibilities to these circles, his duties to his nation or his state, and his responsibilities to nature and its peace. He is social in his encouragement and, I hesitate to use the word evangelism, but his encouragement and evangelism, if you will, for advocating the realization that we've been talking about to others who are willing to open their eyes. Just as well, he is antisocial, as he rejects brainless conformity to the whims of those who do not realize or manifest the greatness that he seeks to achieve. And he's antisocial to those who apathetically ignore and turn blind eye to the beauties of life, or worse yet, those who actively seek to snuff out his awareness. Whereas the masses will conform and consume at the cost of the world around them, like sheep destroying their own pasture, the Strivalist knows his surroundings and instead is an active creator or even an auteur for the good.
So I like what you said about the evangelism.
Mm-hmm.
I encountered somebody, well, not personally. I saw a video either on YouTube or maybe another social media platform, but it was somebody, he was talking about if you are religious and you're not proselytizing,
mm-hmm.
then I can't respect you because you have so little faith in your own worldview.
Mm-hmm.
That you're not willing to share it and tell people about it all the time. I think our worldview is worth sharing with people. So I think evangelizing in a way is good. I think a lot of times I want to say that the Strivalist will wake up more workers. But unfortunately, I think the Strivalist is some sort of random awakening that someone has.
Right.
And so what better way for us to almost, you know, erect some sort of sign that says, hey, if you're awake, go this way, and point towards Strivalism, right? And then I agree that he is antisocial as he rejects brainless conformity. I think it's more of a, he's not necessarily antisocial, but he is rejecting the over-socialization
yes.
that the modern world
yes.
provides. The globo homo.
Yes.
Right?
Tick History. Have you watched any of his videos on YouTube?
Honestly, I just watched one today, which is very strange that you
read that up. Incredibly interesting stuff. He did a video where he talked about socialism.
Yeah.
And he had a very fresh take on what socialism is. And he said it's not a specifically left-leaning or right-leaning ideology. It's an ideology of monolithic socialism, or you create a monolithic society in which everyone adheres to this one ideology, be it fascism or communism, or even you could even have it be religious in some sort of connotation. So it was very interesting what you just said. He is rejecting the over-socialization. He is rejecting the extra-social, the forced social, the being cog in the machine.
Right. I think the over-socialization happens too. I mean, to an extent, we're talking about more forbidden authors here.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't just Ted Kaczynski, but he was the main one, I think. But when he was referring to over-socialization, it was, I mean, for thousands of years, we lived in smaller villages mm-hmm. and only knew maybe 200 people at max. Mm-hmm. That's like the low end of your Facebook friends in terms of number. But to be interacting with as many people as we do on a daily basis, and to be able to go on the internet and see every culture at every mm-hmm. second of every day, and you get thousands of hours of stuff almost every day, that can put a certain strain on the human mind, if you will. And it definitely crushes our spirit. It oftentimes I find that people don't have their own personalities. They have just mimicked a personality from their favorite TV show or movie or
it causes
or book,
like
but less or so because no one reads.
Yeah. It causes like a hyper dilution of the self.
Right. And that's what I was referring to when I was talking about the spirit of man is almost overstretched, like, you know, too little butter over bread.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The spirit of man is thinned out because of not just the sheer biomass or the sheer population size of what many people would call humanity.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I'm specifically referring to Western kind or Western people, right? Our spirit is also diluted.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost infected by other cultures because we've become such a globo homo society that mm-hmm. we have basically our culture has become the baseline. And so what was great, our cathedrals, our art style, our music, right? That's now just baseline zero.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have basically attributed no value to it. I think it's because familiarity causes some sort of animosity.
Mm-hmm.
We've become over-familiarized with our own culture that we are so desperate to get literally anything else.
I mean, it's no different than when you're coming of age and you're living at home. You get really tired of your family really quick.
Yeah.
I think it's essentially the same thing.
Right, but the prodigal son always returns.
It's true.
And so I think you almost have to, I don't know, in a sense it's good to travel and understand or, you know, visit or, mm-hmm. you know, whatever, someone else's culture just so you can appreciate yours more. I think what we've done with the advent of the internet and technological society before that and things like that, we became oversaturated in our own.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's almost like, I don't know, do kids intuitively just like have Disney movies like implanted in them? Do they just know
these
stories?
Actually, no, that's a perfect example. My girlfriend is a perfect example. She has never seen Pocahontas. She has never seen, I think the only original, you know, animated Disney movie that she's seen is The Little Mermaid. But she can tell you what Pinocchio is about. She can tell you what Pocahontas is about, or fucking give me another one. The Lion King. She's never seen that. Who hasn't seen that? But I think it's so ingrained and it's such a ubiquitous idea in our culture that if you don't know it, then who are you? Everyone knows it, even if they haven't seen it.
Right.
It's so ingrained in our culture.
I'm trying to rectify that with what we've just said, because I was talking about how familiarity causes animosity.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we're seeing the animosity come out as maybe casting different race actors as the original character. Is that the animosity? Because
I don't know, because there are two sides to that coin, I would argue.
Right, because people want that story still, which is good. But I think stories, because if you make a proper story, the archetypal hero's journey, that is a species-wide
mm-hmm.
thing. It's all across, you know.
Right.
It's in Asia. It's in Africa. It's
in the It shouldn't matter America. Who's cast in it. It just,
right. The story itself is what's important, basically. It's not the actors or the color of anyone playing. I mean, hell, it could be aliens. I mean, people will literally suspend all forms of disbelief to watch aliens talking, and we don't know what they look like and things like that. But at any rate, I think the animosity is just coming from the aesthetics.
Mm-hmm.
People are tired of that aesthetic, and they want something else so desperately. It's because the problem with traditionalism is you can get hunkered down in a position where you are no longer creative.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're not creating anything new or of value, you're only making copies of copies of copies. Have you ever done that with a photocopy machine?
Mm-hmm.
and you keep making copies, eventually it's just so diluted that it's the original image is just gone. But yet anyone who knows what the original looked like can see it in the diluted image. Almost, yeah. I think people are sick that the image isn't perfect, and so they're changing it.
Mm-hmm.
But at any rate, yeah, we kind of got off topic there, but we were talking about the antisocial nature of the Strivalist. Like, yes. he's an anarch type person.
Yes.
Not an anarchist, but he wants to be separate from the world in which we find ourselves in currently.
Right. From and the machine. He wants to be separate from the machine.
Right. And here, I'm going to get into that. Previously, I have exclaimed that the Strivalist seeks to be an independent. This is false. I want everyone to hear that. I have said that the Strivalist seeks to be an independent. He does not. This is false. The Strivalists all together seek to be independent of the system in which we find ourselves at present. Once the system is overthrown, replaced, or we are fully removed from it, there is no need for further exclusion. Right? Mm-hmm. We will have built our own society.
Mm-hmm.
We will have built our own civilization. We don't need to continuously, you know, bash what it no longer exists.
Right. Right?
As aforementioned, there is no such thing as a lone, independent human, as there is no such unit. It just does not exist, right? The smallest unit in the world of the Strivalist, this being the world of nature, is the family, as it is impossible to exist without a biological mother and a biological father, who are furthermore necessary in our development, seeing as though we are wholly reliant on them for the first decade and a half of our lives. And we are born useless, so let us together become stronger.
I just, this passed through my head as you were saying that, with the, there's no such thing as a lone independent, as there is no such unit. Is a couple episodes ago in the first season, when we were talking about the determinism and causality and how everything is interconnected, and we were talking about how no object or event exists in a vacuum, so too are people.
Right.
So no person exists in a vacuum, and no person is independent of what got him there in the first place.
Right.
So very interesting.
Yeah, and I've talked about independence and individualism, right? Mm. Individualism is you have a somewhat vague identity. It may not even truly exist, but you are an individual part of a larger system, right? Mm. And independent is outside of the system,
mm-hmm.
of which we currently find ourselves. Right.
It isn't dependent. It's in the root of, I mean, it's in the root of the word.
Right. You can exist in the time, but mm-hmm. above the time or outside of the time, mm-hmm. right? You always, I mean, we call people like this old souls or mm-hmm. something like that, right? But if only they had the amalgamation of different things that they are old for, that they don't mm-hmm. belong in this time for, right? They have maybe an affinity towards reading, you know, very deep and profound literature, you know, something with gravitas, but they also like this kind of music, and they also like X, Y, and Z that separates them so far from the culture that everyone's like, well, they're not even, I can't even relate to them in a way. That's almost a good thing, but not to the point where somebody is so antisocial or so awkward that it's like autistic in a sense, right? But going back to the purpose of strivalism, right? The purpose of strivalism is to restore nature as the ruler of the world, not man. Right now, in our current technological industrial system, we are under the impression that man is the ruler of the world.
Mm-hmm.
We are but shepherds for evolution, right? We have this rationale where we can almost guide our own evolution in a way. So we must develop ourselves into a disciplined, sophisticated, and truly progressing species. The progress that we have right now is not progress at all. What have we done in the last 300 years since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution to progress ourselves as a species?
Right.
sure, we have a greater population number and we have technology that can take us to the moon or to some Hollywood studio. take of that what you will. Right. But what have we done to truly improve the human condition beyond just materials, right? We have a serious materialism problem. Mm-hmm. The development of the body and mind as instruments of nature's will and to provide the self with the ability to expertly fulfill the biological imperative beyond just the self and the species, right? So that's part of the purpose of strivalism, right? We want to develop not only the body, so I'm talking about physical fitness, right? And I'm talking about developing the mind, someone who can think critically, independently, someone that can think outside of the, you know, proverbial box, right? We have the ability, as I said, to guide our own evolution, right? And so in doing so, when we guide our own evolution, right, we are fulfilling the biological imperative beyond just survive.
Right? Yes.
We must leave behind evidence of Earth's existence for all the universe to see, for all time, as long as the universe exists. It must be known that the light of man's consciousness, the fire of consciousness, will shine bright across the cosmos. That's a huge goal in strivalism. You're not doing any of this for yourself. All this self-development that I'm talking about is for the betterment of the species. Mm-hmm. And strivalism is for the betterment of the species. But we have to cut off the deadheads. Mm-hmm. We have to cut off the vestigial parts of us that are holding us back.
That's a good way of describing that, vestigial.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Freedom is the underlying reason for our movement, for strivalism. Not a freedom from responsibility. No, we do not seek regressing into an eternal infantile state. Our freedom is the determination of imposing responsibility and duty upon the self in order to overcome obstacles on our way to fulfilling the biological imperative and the ramp cycle. The values of strivalism are and should be consistent with this. Right? So, let me go back. Right? When people think of freedom, they think of this careless utopian state, right? Where they have no responsibilities whatsoever, and we see that happening in the real world. People want to stay with their parents for an extended amount of time. Maybe they don't want to go to work, they don't want to get their driver's license, they don't want to start a family, right? And it can be difficult, right? But if you're existing in the first world, you have no excuse, right? I don't care what the inflation rate is. Mm-hmm. Do more, right? You have the ability to do more, right? And so real freedom is that ability to go do more.
And the willpower,
right?
To do so.
Right, and willpower grants freedom. Mm-hmm. Right. And so that's why the disciplining and sharpening and development of the self is so important, because then you can start manipulating the world around you in such a way that benefits not just you, but your kin or your volk.
and going back a little bit, you said do more. That does not necessarily mean in the context of us, whatever the inflation rate is or what the economy looks like.
More inflation.
Do more does not just mean work harder, be more of a wage slave. A strivalist would not be below tearing the system down so that it would be easier. You have to have the willpower to manifest these things regardless of what that would take.
Right.
Whether it requires you staying within the system, which is not a very strivalistic idea, or bucking the system or working independently of it.
Right. Right. Yeah, you can work hard without, like, you don't get paid any more to work hard at an Amazon warehouse. Mm-hmm. You can work your wage, right? Mm-hmm. Working harder there isn't really going to help you. Mm-hmm. What I mean by working harder is networking or utilizing the resources that you have in a more efficient way. But at any rate, we have real freedom, the freedom that the strivalist seeks, is the ability to impose responsibilities and duties upon yourself in order to overcome obstacles in your way, right? And you welcome this conflict, mm-hmm. right? That's the whole point of strivalism, right? Strife, conflict, struggle, right? The old iron and blood type thing, right? You want to fulfill the biological imperative in the most efficient and effective way, right? And not just for your own self. We are above that because we have instinct, emotion, and rationale. So therefore, I have discovered that there is a certain cycle that we must follow, right? It's four simple steps, right? It's the ramp cycle: reproduction, adaptation, maintenance, and production, right? So let me go through each of those. The strivalist's first and foremost duty is to reproduce. This is the action of life affirming life, the propagation of a higher form of our species. I'm talking about strivalists being a higher form of our species. They are above the masses, right? Not only in IQ, but in physical fitness and in willpower and spirit, right? In the species with which we share our world, right? We must also propagate them as well. As I said, we're shepherds of our own evolution. We did not evolve in a vacuum. Right. Therefore, all these other species on the planet are also significant to us, right? And, you know, helping them out is paramount to our, you know, to life's long-term survival in general, mm-hmm. right? And if we are life-affirming life, then taking care of the other species is important. And we'll go back to that when I'm talking about maintenance here in a little bit. But this is important, right? In order to reproduce for our own species, we're also talking about reproducing ideas as well. Mm-hmm. It's not just the physical reproduction, sperm meets egg. We're talking about the reproduction of art, of culture, things like that as well. Mm-hmm. Right? And that's, as I said, paramount to our long-term survival and expansion into the cosmos. Next up is adaptation. Not only to new environments, but in the geographical sense, but also to situations that cannot be overcome simply by the lazy technological overcoming of them, right? And it would be easy to climb a mountain with a gondola. Is it a gondola?
It's a gondola.
Yeah, right. It would be easy to climb a mountain like that, but you didn't conquer it. You get no satisfaction. You find no meaning. You find no true development of the self in doing so like that.
There's no journey.
Right. And evolution is not a series of solutions to a problem. It is the elimination of problems and changes made to the survivors, right? So it's the elimination of problems and it is changes made to the survivors. We must adapt new ways of generating our own evolution and push beyond our boundaries of comfort. We do not adapt to become comfortable. We adapt to overcome.
I like that. I like that a lot.
Next up is maintenance. The maintenance of a species takes place within the ecosphere, the food web, etc. This balance between population and resources is not limited to the increase of resources, but also a limitation and refining of the population in tandem with the former. I say that almost hesitantly. culling of the weak is a phrase that comes to mind. Maybe we'll revisit that.
There's a
Pentilinkola.
There's a lot there.
Yeah, Pentilinkola, the Finnish author, was talking about if you truly love life, you'll cut the hands off of everyone that's in the water drowning, trying to grab onto the lifeboat, because mm-hmm. they'll sink the lifeboat too. Mm-hmm. So if strivalists are the lifeboat, right? If we are the lifeboat that will, you know, succeed or survive the mm-hmm. collapse of Western civilization, everyone that tries to jump on might not exactly be a strivalist. Mm-hmm. And so in order to ensure the survivability of our species and of strivalism, we must, if you truly love life, mm-hmm. you'll cut all the masses' hands off so that they cannot get on the boat.
I mean, it's no different than gardening. If you have a garden and you have a flower that's diseased, you rip that flower out.
Right.
Before it infects the rest of your garden.
Right. As beautiful as the flower may have been, it must go. Mm-hmm. You have to deadhead the plants that are going, because they're just choking out other plants.
Right.
Yeah.
Pruning.
Pruning.
Well, I mean, like a bonsai tree.
Yeah.
We're stretching the analogy here, but you get what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, sometimes you have to illustrate like that for people mm-hmm. to understand the image, because I just said kill the masses, and it sounded...
We're pruning the masses.
We are pruning mankind mm-hmm. of its useless and vestigial forms, of which we are a part of. We are the masses.
Yes, you and me and whoever's listening, we're not immune to that.
If you've made it this far, you're not immune to the culling.
The culling.
Yeah. The production of culture, right? This is the fourth and final. Production of culture, art, and tools dominated and manifested by our will, aesthetics, strength, and purpose is wholly necessary. These things, not buzzwords or lame political discourse, will provide purpose and meaning to our lives, right? And so when we do things, right, when we make art, real art has layers of symbolism and meaning, and it connects Western canon together. Mm-hmm. You can see that in many of the classical artworks that have lasted, you know, throughout the ages, right? They didn't fall out of fame or importance, right? And I'm not talking about the ones in the last maybe 100 years. I'm sure there are some. I'm 100% positive that there are many, mm-hmm. if not a good amount. But we've come to the point where we're abstracting, right? But at any rate, so we've talked about reproduction, adaptation, maintenance, and production, right? Once we have all these results and they start working, we reproduce the results that worked. We reproduce our successes, and then we wash, rinse, and repeat. When we do these things, we will create the layers of symbolism and connective ideas, serving as the connective tissue of the new body of new civilization. And we've talked about how Spengler and many other people have referenced the Western world as a body, and it is rotting and decaying, right? Mm-hmm. I opened up discourses on strivalism with the idea that the West is dead. We are living in its bloated and rotting corpse. We're mm-hmm. mimicking life within it. Let's give civilization a new body. And I think we have enough symbols from Western canon and ideas that we can connect with, right? And honestly, I mean, I look at my library sometimes and I think, man, it all started with me reading one book and he referenced an author. So I bought books mm-hmm. by that author who referenced other authors and back and forth. And I mean, my library...
The interconnectedness is just insane.
Right. And I'm starting to find that, like, I might be taking this like personal or something, like some sort of manifest destiny in a way. But I feel like a lot of these authors were writing for so that someone else would pick up their work and do something with it. And I find other authors that have done the same thing. And so I feel like it's some sort of cosmic funnel of information from throughout the ages that eventually landed in my lap and your lap as well. You've read almost all the books that I have, right? Mm-hmm. And the same, you know, vice versa.
Right.
And so I feel that, you know, this is quite an emotional take, right? And there's not a lot of rationale to it. But suppose, if you will, that when somebody writes something, they intend for somebody to read it. Mm-hmm. Well, when somebody like me reads it and understands or even just attempts to connect other authors to that and tries to create something from it, I think that was their intent. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like it has all funneled down to me, and I hope other people feel like that too.
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of it has to do with it's our way of staving off the finality of death.
Right, right. You want to leave a legacy. Mm-hmm. That's strivalists want to leave a legacy, too. Mm-hmm. I talk about that with making sure that the light of human consciousness never goes extinct in the cosmos. Even if we are a fragment of concrete or something mm-hmm. is found in the galaxy and they go, this was artificially made. Mm-hmm. We live on.
I think an interesting way of looking at what we see today is take the ancient Egyptians. We still talk about them. It's a civilization that was, you know, 4,000 to 6,000 years ago. Why do we still talk about them? Because we're still finding things out about them.
Right.
There are these enormous monuments to them.
Can you imagine
that essentially alien... just say, we're here. I was here.
I existed. I was here. That's mm-hmm. why they left handprints in the exactly. caves. They existed. They were here.
That is our ultimate goal, is to prove that we were here and to make it meaningful while we are here.
As or long as the sun burns. Future. As long as the sun burns.
So we've only got about 4 billion years.
That's an eternity.
Yes.
No, I feel like I have some sort of responsibility. I have found all the pieces of a puzzle. Maybe not all, but I'm starting to get an image from all these pieces of a puzzle. And I feel like it's my responsibility to complete this picture. And I think strivalism is meant... I mean, it almost came to me in a dream, in a sense. It's my responsibility to the world to present them with this. And you feel the same way. That's Absolutely. Why you're here, sitting Absolutely. With me in this room, talking about this.
Which is what makes it even more amazing that we're two separate people that came from two separate, you know, upbringings.
Right.
And we've generally come to the same conclusion. That there's something, and that's what we're trying to scratch the surface of. I mean, that's the purpose of these podcasts. I mean, we've been having these conversations, and finally we've just gotten around to recording them and making them a little bit more structured.
Yeah.
Eventually, the goal, hopefully, is to have a very concise idea of the realization that we've been talking about.
Right, and this is where you listeners, if you've made it this far... This is where you guys come in, where you debate with us, because we may have found ourselves in an echo chamber. Mm-hmm. Well, we always agree with each other. Not necessarily always. We do have, I mean, if you've listened to any of the podcasts, we've disagreed with each other before. But if anyone has a differing idea or a different understanding of Aristotle or somebody mm-hmm. that I've mentioned before, right, give us your understanding.
Right.
So that we, together, may become stronger.
Right.
Because it's almost like strivalism could be symbolized as a bundle of rods surrounding an axe. If only there was a name for something like that. But anyway. Do you have anything else?
No, I'm all set.
I think we did very good. We're 47.
Wow. That was perfect timing today.
Well... Make sure you like, subscribe, leave a comment, message us in our email. We'll leave that in the video description.
And our quadrillionth subscriber.
Oh my goodness.
Because we had trillion last time. Our quadrillionth subscriber.
Gets a hand-signed copy of the Book of Strivalism.
Yes.
Which will be printed soon, someday.
Yes.
Very soon. 100 years. I had to stop you before you offered... quadrillion dollars. Can't do that.
Well, hey, at this inflation rate.
Maybe by this time next year, we can actually do that.
Exactly.
Will our subscribers inflate? That is the question.
Hopefully to a quadrillion.
On that note.